In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Saint Thomas Aquinas, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, the chapter I present of Introduzione a San Tommaso is the Magisterium of the Church and the authority on the authority or doctrinal authority of Saint Thomas Aquinas. We follow one part of this presentation follows this chapter of Father Fabro, and I complete with the teachings of Paul VI and John Paul II. Well, the first thing that we have to mention is that with his canonization in 1323, Saint Thomas centered in the thought and activity of the Church. So we will take a look to the texts of the popes in favor of the doctrinal authority of St. Thomas, and the most important one is Leo XIII with the encyclical Eterni Patris in 1879. In those times, the Church was accused by modern scholars of not paying attention to the role of reason in academic life. So the Pope reacted with the encyclical Eterni Patris, which invites professors of theology and philosophy to revitalize the study of philosophy according to the method and doctrine of St. Thomas Aquinas. It is a point in the whole history of the Church, the harmony between faith and reason. Scholars in those times accused the Church of not only not paying attention to speculative work, the work of reason, but making a confrontation, the Church is accused of making a confrontation of faith against reason, as if the knowledge of faith destroyed the knowledge of reason. So the Pope, in the first part of the encyclical, a sort of introduction, explains how the whole history of the Church worked in this harmony between faith and reason. That's why he quotes the fathers of the Church, apostolic and apologists, and the great bishops of both East and West. So always the Church worked in this mission of harmonizing faith and reason. And the most excellent examples of, we have of this work, and we find in St. Augustine and in medieval period, especially in St. Bonaventure and St. Thomas Aquinas. And when he comes to this point on St. Thomas Aquinas, the encyclical is devoted to promote him because of his precision in presenting the doctrine of the Church both in philosophical and theological studies. And this authority of St. Thomas is not reduced to the Dominican order, but also extends to the great orders of the Church, such as Benedictines, Carmelites, Jesuits, etc. As the Pope says, it is known that nearly all the founders and lawgivers of the religious orders commanded their members to study and religiously adhere to the teachings of St. Thomas, fearful lest any of them should serve even in the slightest degree from the footsteps of so great a man. Also, Leo XIII lists the main interventions on behalf of St. Thomas of his predecessors from the 14th through the 18th centuries, the popes, and particularly the ecumenical councils of Lyons, Vienna, Florence, Vatican I, and especially the authority of St. Thomas is reflected, is manifested especially in the Council of Trent. The chief and special glory of Thomas, which he has shared with none of the Catholic doctors, is that the fathers of the Council of Trent made part of the order of conclave to lay upon the altar, together with sacred scripture and decrees of the Supreme Pontiffs, the Summa of Thomas Aquinas, whence to seek counsel, reason, and inspiration. St. Thomas, Leo XIII finds in St. Thomas both the response against accusations and at the same time the renewal of philosophical studies. He is convinced that sciences will improve provided that scholars go back to St. Thomas. I skipped some texts for reason of time. Well, after presenting the accuracy of St. Thomas in philosophy and theology, the Pope encourages all bishops to work in this enterprise of restoring Thomas Aquinas in the academic life of the Church. And this revival of Thomism is built upon two pillars. First of all, the revival of Thomism is built upon, first of all, the pillar of the absolute preeminence of St. Thomas. And Leo XIII speaks to professors. They should illumine the minds of students with the doctrines of Aquinas. We exhort you, venerable brethren, in all earnestness to restore the golden wisdom of St. Thomas and to spread it far and wide for the defense and beauty of the Catholic faith, for the good of society, and for the advantage of all sciences. Let carefully selected teachers, endeavor to implant the doctrine of Thomas Aquinas in the minds of students and set forth clearly his solidity and excellence over all else. And let universities already founded or to be founded by you, speaking to bishops, illustrate and defend this doctrine and use it for the refutation of prevailing errors. First of all, the predominance of St. Thomas. And the second pillar is the necessity of studying St. Thomas in his original texts. But lest the false for the true or the corrupt for the pure be drunk in, be you watchful that the doctrine of Thomas be drawn from his own fountains. So to read the works of St. Thomas. So the great merit of the encyclical consists in the fact that Leo XIII proclaims St. Thomas not as one of the masters of the Church, but rather her own master, her favorite master, her own master, St. Thomas. Five practical decisions follow the encyclical. After the encyclical was issued, five ways of executing it we find in the history of the Church. First of all, institution of the Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas to promote the study of philosophy in the light of Aquinas, 1879. Secondly, a critical edition of the works of St. Thomas with the commentary of Cayetan for the Summa Theologiae and of Sylvester of Ferrara for the Summa Contra Gentiles, 1980. Is the Leonina, no? A year later, of the encyclical, St. Thomas is proclaimed, this is the third consequence, St. Thomas is proclaimed patron of all Catholic schools. The fourth one, a faculty of Thomistic philosophy is open at the University of Louvain, under the supervision of Cardinal Mercier. And the fifth one, okay, a letter to the General of the Franciscans, he shows that it's his will that the order, the friars, follow the doctrine of St. Thomas. And this applies to all them, of course, in consequence to all religious orders. No? Well, this is a summary of the main intervention of a Pope in favor of St. Thomas Aquinas, is the revival of Thomism. Leo XIII with encyclical Eterni Patris, and the consequence of how it was put into practice in these five ways. Now we pass to consider St. Pius X. St. Pius X will move in the same direction of Leo XIII. First, next year he became a Pope, he will issue the brief to the Roman Pontifical Academy St. Tommaso. It confirms here the statements of Leo XIII. He says that it is necessary to explain, to protect, and to propagate the sound doctrine of the Church, especially by studying the philosophy and theology of the Doctor Angelicus. 10 years later, the 24 Thomistic Theses were issued by the Sacred Congregation of Studies. And the same Pope, in a motu proprio, will declare the link between the 24 Thomistic Theses and this brief of 1904. Well, first of all, this brief. Then the encyclical Pascendi. The Pope assures that against the attack of modernism, the return to philosophy is not enough. If we return to philosophy in general, this is not enough. It is necessary to return to the philosophy of St. Thomas Aquinas. To have already studied the humanities who devote themselves for 2 years at least to philosophy and 4 years to theology, following the teaching of St. Thomas, in accordance with the vision of the Holy See. And then Canon 1366, the second paragraph, the study of philosophy and theology and the teaching of the sciences to the student must be accurately carried out by professors according to the arguments, doctrine, and principles of St. Thomas, which they are inviolably to hold in the canon law. As Pius XI says, our predecessor Benedict XV is to be praised for having promulgated the code of canon law, in which the system, philosophy, and principles of the angelic doctor are unreservedly sanctioned. Well, okay, now we pass to Pius XI, and first of all, the encyclical letter Studiorum Duce. Of course, Pope XI reaffirmed the statements of his predecessors on St. Thomas' authority, and having listed the popes from all centuries, he approves what all the popes said about St. Thomas, and he declares, "We consider that Thomas should be called not only the angelic, but also the common or universal doctor of the Church, doctor communis." For the Church has adopted his philosophy for her own, as innumerable documents of every kind attest. I didn't read, no, but all popes the predecessor, right? 10 predecessors since the canonization of St. Thomas to the 20th century. Pius XI will justify his statement by praising both the spiritual and intellectual life of St. Thomas, and he concludes by quoting St. Pius X. Let professors remember that they cannot set St. Thomas aside, especially metaphysic questions, without great detriment. It's a quotation of the Passion. And the Pope draws four conclusions. First of all young men should consider the example of St. Thomas, model of life for youth. The secondly, the same of course applies to seminarians and members of religious communities, and also to all the faithful. St. Thomas model for students in the church. The third, it's interesting what Pius XI says, ite ad Thomam, I read somewhere that phrase. He says, if we wish to avoid modern errors, we are to adhere to St. Thomas. And he says, accordingly, just as it was said to the Egyptians of old in time of famine, go to Joseph, so that they should receive supply of corn from his nursery to nourish their bodies, so we now say to all such as are desirous of the truth, go to Thomas and ask him to give you from his ample store the food of substantial doctrine wherewith to nourish your souls unto eternal life. Go to Thomas. Ite ad Thomam. And the fourth consequence, professors, he says, and those who are engaged in teaching the higher studies in seminaries, diligently to observe and inviolably to maintain the decrees of our predecessors. We have to be faithful to them. Let everyone therefore observe the prescription containing the code of canon law, and may they conform to this rule so faithfully as to be able to describe him in very truth as their master. The second document in favor of the authority of St. Thomas, we find in the Apostolic Constitution, Deus Scientiarum Dominus. And here, Pius XI declares two things especially. First of all, a place of honor should be given to theology presented with the two methods, positive and speculative, and especially regarding the speculative method, according to the principles of St. Thomas in all theological faculties. And secondly, philosophy must be taught by following the principles and method of St. Thomas. The principles, not only the method, the principles. From this point of view, the other philosophical systems should be examined and judged. From this point of view, from St. Thomas, all the other philosophical systems should be examined and judged. And we pass to Pius XII in the encyclical Humanae Generis, in confrontation especially with Nouvelle Theologie, modernism that was back, okay, at least publicly, and in confrontation also with the atheistic existentialism and evolutionism, Pius XII recalls first of all the canon law regarding the authority of St. Thomas Aquinas. When we say Gustavus St. Thomas Aquinas, it is the canon law. And then how modern studies, against how to respond the objection coming from modern studies against scholastic philosophy, and especially St. Thomas, he says, let no Christian, therefore, whether philosopher or theologian, embrace eagerly and lightly whatever novelty happens to be thought of from day to day, but rather let him weigh with painstaking care and a balanced judgment, lest he lose or corrupt the truth he already has. Discerning, okay? With a great danger, with great danger and damage to his faith. And he continues, if one considers all this well, he will easily see why the Church demands that future priests be instructed in philosophy, according to the method, doctrine, and principles of the angelic doctrine. You can see. I highlight, no? I mean, not only the method, no? As we heard recently, maybe, especially because of his method,
yes.
But not only that. According to the method, doctrine, and principles of the angelic doctrine. Since, as we will know from the experience of centuries, the method of Aquinas is singularly preeminent, both of teaching students and bringing truth to light, first because of his method, and his doctrine is in harmony with divine revelation and is most effective both for safeguarding the foundation of the faith and for reaping safely and usefully the fruits of some progress. Well, by the 12th. There is no special mention on John the 23rd. So we pass to Paul the 6th. It's important, Paul the 6th, because it's after Vatican II, and Vatican II and after Vatican II, that the authority of St. Thomas is not something that was before Vatican II, taught by the popes and now something obsolete, okay? No, Paul the 6th keeps this authority and keeps all the decisions that his predecessors told or issued about St. Thomas Aquinas. So the first thing that we find during the government of the papacy of Paul the 6th is the Council Vatican II, and in two documents of the Church, the authority of St. Thomas Aquinas is recommended. Optatantosios 16, when it explains how to study dogmatic theology, in order that seminarians may illumine the mysteries of salvation as completely as possible, the students should learn to penetrate them more deeply with the help of speculation under the guidance of St. Thomas. Gravissimo educaciones in the same way, in the same year. Thus, in the end, investigation should be made according to the example of the doctors of the Church, and especially of St. Thomas Aquinas. Also, in the Ratio Fundamentalis Institutionis Sacerdotalis of 1970, the last one is 2016, the same disposition is found here. In paragraph 86, we are told, consider St. Thomas Aquinas as one of the highest masters of the Church. And it is particularly important the apostolic letter, Lumen Ecclesiae, in 1974, issued by Paul the 6th. Again, because of the authority that Paul the 6th gives to St. Thomas. By doing so, he reaffirms what popes had said already about him. And here the first phrase that we find here, I find it very important because he will interpret it. What is the role of St. Thomas? Is one, of course we have to study other authors, yes, but particularly St. Thomas, or St. Pius X, no? Okay, he says, we call attention to the extraordinary, even if unforeseen, return to St. Thomas, which has confirmed the wisdom of the Supreme Magisterium in declaring him to be authoritative, irreplaceable guide in philosophy and theology. In that quotation he quotes himself, it's in another address, somewhere in 1970, if I am not mistaken. But the importance of the expression, no? Is irreplaceable guide in philosophy and theology. He will justify this. In the letter justifies why St. Thomas Aquinas is irreplaceable in philosophy and theology. We must therefore give our explicit approval to those who maintain that even 700 years after his death, the holy doctor is to be venerated not only as a supreme genius and teacher of the past, no? But also for the continuing relevance of his principles, teaching, and of his teaching. by the prophet to be derived from the study and consultation of his writings, and by the power of his teaching to persuade and form the minds of students, especially the younger ones. The Pope knows that not all agree with his words. We are aware, he says, we are aware that not all of our contemporaries share our view, of course, but we know too that their distrust or repugnance is often due to a superficial and casual acquaintance with his teaching, which is true. They never read St. Thomas properly. They just criticize him, as we can see in some books. Therefore, like Pius XI, it's actual what Pius XI is, it's not obsolete. Awesome. We urge all who wish to form a mature judgment in this matter, and he says, go to Thomas, ite ad Thomas, and ad Thomas. Obtain and read his works, not simply to find safe nourishment in his rich intellectual treasure, but also and especially to gain personal grasp of the sublimity, abundance, and importance of the doctrine contained therein. He will justify these assertions with the rest of the letter. Well, the letter concludes, the letter Lumen Ecclesiae, with three consequences. First of all, those with ecclesiastical calling oblige them to the study and teaching of theology must energetically apply themselves to the indispensable task of making the angelic doctor's teaching understood in all its vitality outside the narrow confines of the classroom. A person is a teacher of theology, teaches St. Thomas, studies St. Thomas and teaches St. Thomas. We are following Paul VI. Second, important the dialogue with Mother Conjure, of course. Those who wish to be St. Thomas's disciples today have a further obligation to take a careful account of the chief concerns of those who are looking for a deeper understanding of the faith. Because St. Thomas has answered for that. We find the answer in St. Thomas. Unless this is done, the faith cannot affect, much less be a vital influence on their minds. We don't do this. Third, the need of entering into vital communion with St. Thomas himself through an ongoing dialogue with him. There can be no authentic, fruitful fidelity unless we receive from St. Thomas himself the principles which act as beacons shedding light on the more important philosophical questions and rendering the faith more intelligible to our age. St. John Paul II. We had the first intervention, the address, the address to the 8th International Domestic Congress in 1980. Again, he recommends, he reaffirms the doctrine of the popes in favor of St. Thomas Aquinas' doctrine. He explained that it has been especially for the doctrine on faith and reason about which St. Thomas reached the height of all scholastic theology and philosophy, or the progress finds its summit in St. Thomas. Progress that through in the history of Catholic dogma, no? Or Catholic doctrine rather. Well, as it is usually in theology and philosophy, as is usually called and said, the central pivot in the church around which St. Thomas, no? At that time, and since that time, Christian thought could be developed with sure progress. And he quotes Paul VI. And John Paul II adds, it is for this reason that the Church has given preference to the method and doctrine, again, method and doctrine, of the angelic doctor, while other than exclusive preference, this deals with an exemplary preference that permitted Leo XIII to declare him to be the Interscholasticus Doctores Omnium Principes et Magister. Then the rest of the address again is justifies this statement by recommending again the Leo XIII and how his teachings are still valid on the authority of Saint Thomas. And he concludes on Paul II with a special request. I urge you to continue the International Ecumenical Congress. I urge you to continue. To continue with great commitment and seriousness to accomplish the goals of your academy so that it can be a living, pulsing, modern center in which the method and doctrine of St. Thomas can be put into continuous contact and serene dialogue with contemporary culture in which we live and are immersed. The Canon Law 1983 keeps the Canon Law 1917 on the necessity of keeping St. Thomas as a sure guide in our studies. Canon 252, students have to learn to penetrate more intimately the mysteries of salvation, especially with St. Thomas as a teacher. And finally, St. John II reaffirms the chosen interest in philosophy, and particularly in Thomistic philosophy, in the encyclical Fides et Ratio. And the first thing we find when he comes to this point is that he reaffirms, he has said, how the doctrine and the words of Leo XIII must be kept in our hearts, in our memories as well. A renewed insistence upon the thought of the angelic doctor seemed to Pope Leo XIII the best way to record the practice of a philosophy consonant with the demands of faith. And he John Paul II now continues with this intention of Leo XIII. Once again, the recommendation of St. Thomas. He says, it has been necessary from time to time to intervene on this question. Not only the Leo XIII, we have seen how all the popes had to recommend St. Thomas time to time, over and over again. To reiterate the value of the angelic doctor's insight and insist on the study of his thought. This has been because the magisterium's directives have not always been followed with the readiness one would wish. In the years after the Second Vatican Council, many Catholic faculties were in some ways impoverished by a diminished sense of the importance of the study, not just of scholastic philosophy, but more generally of the study of philosophy itself. I cannot fail to note with surprise and displeasure that this lack of interest in the study of philosophy is shared by not a few theologians. Well, in conclusion, Father Fabro opines that the most important interventions in favor of Thomism comes from Leo XIII and St. Pius X. Leo XIII in restoring the study of St. Thomas in the life of the Church, and St. Pius X with the mission of implementing the work of Leo XIII. And I think attention should be put on Paul VI, St. Paul VI, especially against those who deem the teachings before Vatican II obsolete. In 1993, Father Fabro told a group of priests, IB priests, that the study of St. Thomas in Latin was extremely important in these days because he opined he saw that Aquinas has the response for all the desires of human interests and hearts. And he said that he hoped that it would be contemporary world, with St. Thomas, it would be a return to St. Thomas. Well, he saw that he had the response for all the desires of human intellects, or rather for the desires of human hearts. No? By following the advice of Father Fabro, we are also following the direction of popes of the 20th century and in studying and giving authority to Saint Thomas.